He is a pastor of words. He captures the book. We have to focus on the book that puts people like him, that brings the people that we. It's a very difficult thing to do. And I've lost most of it, I don't do it anymore. Gravity never works. But what they do is, just like any teacher of school, you read books with great appropriateness. You have books appropriate for kindergartners and first graders, second graders, and it's based on not the content, but the difficulty of the unity. The vocabulary needs, the sentence construction, so on. And then books are rated then at lower books and more gentle. So, the quality of trying to teach people Hebrew and Greek, most people have different objectives. So, you get the 66 books in the Bible, and you rank them based upon their difficulty, your language needs, and so forth. And so, when you start Greek, you have to start that job, because Greek, and you end with Paul writing, or first thing that you get is very, very difficult language. Well, in the Hebrew books of the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah is following the senior Hebrew example. This is just beautifully sculpted and difficult. It is nasty, it is eloquent, it is just a way with words. Of course, we're not calling it highly educated, and that's why we try to get it. Also, the thing about Isaiah is because it is that he actually was born into a privileged family. He knew these things on a personal basis. He served in their court day to day. In fact, when the king Uzziah passed away, he was physically touched and disturbed because of this. He was friends with these people. So, he didn't have a really upstairs, highly educated, color person that served God in the way of being a prophet for the Lord. He was married. We don't know much about his wife other than that he also were a prophetess. So, you really have a husband, wife, too. A prophet and prophetess. They had two boys, at least that we know of. And both of them didn't just have names. Their names actually made things that had theological significance. I don't have time to go into that. There are four major themes that run through the book. And he leaves these three themes throughout his book. It's important to know what they are so that when you read the book of Isaiah, you can understand what he says and how these themes run. The first theme is that of judgment and salvation. Sometimes this theme is applied to the service of the Lord, judging on them and also to you. But quite often, these prophets also have the exact same message for the Israelites. You dig a thing, you throw it forth from your own house. You break in my laws. You repent for judgment to come. Your salvation will be available. So, quite often, there are strong messages for Israel as well. But judgment and salvation flows to the book. So, this is identified as the character of God. All these names, the Greek king, the fire, the guy, the fire, so also. Jesus and Isaiah have the same purpose of correcting the view of who God is. People have the wrong conception of who God is, and by the end of the church, they saw that. In New Testament times, people believed that God was a harsh tyrant that can't wait to make you ill or make you die if you disobey and sin. Jesus can't say that God is not like this. He's a God of love. He's a God of free choice. He's a relational God. And so you find long passages of Isaiah really pointing the speak on the character of God, who God is. And the two subject categories of how he explains God is. The first category is that of holiness. In which it's more about holiness of God than any other book in the Bible. So the topic of God's holiness is removed in Isaiah's mind. But God is not just a sin, but God is holy. The second theme that falls under the character of God is God's sovereignty. And basically, the challenge is like, stop telling God what to do. He's not going to do it. He is here, actually, he is sovereign. He's allowed to do what he wants to do. He is king after all. And so, the sovereignty of God is in his hands as well. And then, the last thing that God's character that Isaiah speaks about is the truth of God. And use the word amen And the word of the name is the word to be saved. When it's used in reference to God, it means that when God says, will be saved, or when God promises, will be saved. Everything is good. It's trustworthy. If God says something, He will do it. Jesus promises, He's faithful, He's beautiful. Again, the last theme that runs through our verse book is there are four major promises that are called servant statements. And what is these four signs? People are the servant. And I want to ask the question today, who is this servant that Isaiah speaks about? Next week, we are going to build on that. And I spend some time reading together Isaiah chapter 53, because that is one of the major servant topics. But what we will do is to come back and get to know who this servant is. Who is this servant for us? Israel, who is serving God before the other nations, and being God's spokespeople to reach other people. Is this servant for us? Our God and Himself, our Father, who is serving God and the people. Or is it for us? So let's go to Isaiah chapter 53, and we'll start off with verse 15. See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. My servant usually raised up and highly exalted. Typically not. Typically, servants are lowly people who serve. So we know there's kind of something different about this servant. He doesn't tell us who the servant is, but that tells us something different. He will act wisely, or sometimes make him be successful, and he is raised up and lifted high to the pulpit. We believe that this text is speaking about dreams, because the New Testament really is speaking about how Jesus is exalted, how Jesus is glorified. But in this event, we don't want us to show you. Next verse. Verse 14. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so distilled beyond that of any man, and his form was beyond the human likeness. It is amazing how he did not agree, he did not stand out of the ground. He looked like him. And also how he was distilled on the cross. And everything that he went through, the people were appalled at what he said sometimes, who he was at other times, and of course, so much so that they crucified him. Some will think of all nations, and kings were something else because of him. So what they were not told, they will see. And what they have not heard, they will understand. The Hebrew Jeremiah also that he will make people see and think differently. He will make them see things they never perceived before. And we can see that Jesus clearly did that in the we see very differently. Prior to Jesus, people served the king. Jesus can record us that God, the king, served Christ. In other religions, people die. So the king. In Christianity, the king dies to save us. Jesus really changes the way people see things and what they hear and understand. Everybody wanted to be so, Jesus changed being a servant. Jesus changed the way we think and the way we see. That's why Christianity is so different. But I'm not sure if we get to this. Which is and they followed him by the fear of their sin. Warning them not to start who he was. How do you think it's going to happen to them? Now, before we get to verse 17, I'd like you to notice what happens to verse 17. The author of the message here says in his text, the way he's talking to the Holy Spirit. I quote the Old Testament in the beginning, right? It's an organization. Let me go on to you. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. You have the New Testament under inspiration and prophecy, what Isaiah spoke of his servant directly to Jesus. Telling us that when Isaiah spoke of his servant, he was named Jesus. Now, I know that for a fact because he actually spoke of them word for word. And he quotes one of these four standard songs. This is the verse 18. And then he's now quoting the prophet Isaiah. Here is my what? Servant. What does chapter 52 say? And chapter 42, chapter 52, the name of these chapters in Isaiah that use this servant song. The message to Jesus says, here is my servant, and he's speaking about Jesus. Here is Jesus, whom I have chosen. The one I love, in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will proclaim justice to the nations. Now, can you think of any other New Testament verses where God declares, there is whom I love and I delight in? Doctor, the book of Matthew, and I can read now, but chapter 3, around verse 17 and so forth, starting with verse 13, in the baptism of Jesus, when he is brought up out of the water, the lens open up, in the form of a dove, and we come down and say, so we don't only have the New Testament actually telling us Jesus is the fulfillment of the prophecy of Isaiah. We have numerous texts that apply the concept of Isaiah to Jesus by being exalted, by being loved and delighted, or being about me, and so forth. And then I'm going to skip down to verse 21. In his name, the nations will put their hope. Yes, the light will fill it up. Yes, the heaven will be filled up. But in his name, the nations will still put their hope in him because it's only for him that salvation can be gained. So here we have the book of Isaiah telling us that this servant who changes the world is Jesus. Where the New Testament fulfillment that who Isaiah spoke of as the servant is Jesus. Can you think of any other text that proclaims us that Jesus was in fact the actual servant? Look at Philippians chapter 2, verse 6 to 8. If you think about Jesus, you look at the previous verses. Jesus, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped or something to hold on to. He gave that up in verse 6, assuredly. But made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. The Greek word used here for servant is the word doulos. The word meaning a servant. A slave, but remember, it's not the poor slave, it's the one who willingly works for his debt, who willingly and lovingly serves his master. Jesus was equal to God. He gave that up and became equal to a servant for you and me, being made in your likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to God, even death on that cross. Jesus became this servant who on the cross bore and paid for the debt. I trust that the disciples still have very clearly understood because these scriptures are very precious. The identity, in particular,
the book of Isaiah is with us throughout the New Testament. So remember when Philip met the Ethiopian, what was the book of reading? Isaiah. When he went to the temple, which book did he open to read? Isaiah. Who else? The book of Isaiah plays a central role to make him look and then the Bible. The truth. So the New Testament people often have known that Jesus is the servant. Not just who was going to rule the Bible, but the servant who holds the word, who plays the commandment, who brings salvation. In the strength that the disciples over and over and over different knowledge of the truth of these things. Who's going to have this today? And then it's with them 2 days after, all over again. And so in another place, you think it's going to be. But then you ask the question. Does God exist? Is it God's children? Why did Jesus ask to explain it? Why did Jesus do the washing of feet and not just do the bread and wine of the Jews? Why specifically did he wash their feet as 4 times in the book of John told us that he was doing it to meet us again before we could go and do the same? Washing. He's trying to teach us a concept. The concept of servanthood. Not force, but servanthood, willing and ready to serve and wash. The last difference is that he's working from Mark chapter 10 to verse 43. Jesus is giving special instructions for us to say, not so with me. He said, whoever wants to be great among you, let me be your servant. The servant concept runs well in Jesus' message. That was the point. What do you think is a message for you and me? What does Jesus want us to do? I mean, Jesus wants us to be servants. Not because of force, not because of nature, but when we are alone, we are servants. And people are other people to take care of us. We are servants. If you look at the entire section of the New Testament church, the New Testament gives us a job description for all of the leaders. And when you look at 1 Peter, as out there, and so forth, it specifically says, elders, you are not to lord over your congregation, you are to serve. We see this theme all throughout the whole church is structured and built upon the concept of service. We know that the deeper into the cross, the deeper into the leaders, the servant. Now you look at the text. But the entire structure of the church was put up for us to be servants of God. This means, in the greater text of the church, is built upon the concept. But for now, my advice is for us to think differently, to change our understanding of why we are here and what Jesus is all about, and to really understand that we are both on this place to be a servant for other people and to serve God in the process as well. Really thank you that you have this passion. May the Holy Spirit be with you. Will you take out the power of your strength and do that in Christ so that we can be saved? We thank you that you are the faithful God and when you promise us here, it is true and true. Help us to work in this world and also to serve one another. Serve the community of our service. So that we will become known as people who are your servants. We
told it to him.